the rabies virus. It's quite a miserable disease. The virus travels up to the brain of the infected person, and death then follows. But it can be something like fatigue, headache, fever. Those can be initial symptoms. And then it can progress into hallucinations, light sensitivity, hydrophobia, a fear of water. And it's all connected with things that go wrong in the brain. It is essentially going to making somebody crazy, and certainly making these animals also crazy. They behave completely abnormal, completely aggressive. This hypersalivation that you get, and this is in humans and in animals. You do get the two forms. The one is the furious form, which is the more common one, the one that I've just explained. Then there's the second manifestation, is the dumb form, in which an animal or a human simply become paralyzed.
How do people get rabies? This common idea is that dogs are the one who bite people and then people get infected, but there's more to it than that.
We calculate that there's almost 60,000 people per year dying from rabies, most of them in Africa and Asia. 99% of them from infected dogs. So dogs really truly are the source of the virus that is then transmitted to humans. A dog gets infected and then transmits that the virus to another dog. Humans then are intermediate hosts. So if you get in the way of a rabid dog, you can be bitten by that dog. By the time the dog is rabid, there would be a lot of virus in the brain. The virus migrates to the salivary glands. When you are then bitten, the virus is transmitted through the saliva. The virus then enters the peripheral nerve system and then travels through the central nervous system all the way to the brain.
And they say about rabies that once the symptoms are manifesting in a person, then it's too late.
Correct. A very important thing about rabies is that it can be prevented through post-exposure. The first thing is when a person is bitten by a suspected rabid animal, that wound must be very thoroughly washed for as long as you can. The WHO, World Health Organization, recommend 15 minutes with soap and water, running water if possible. Thereafter, such a person should get medical care, which would then include a schedule of vaccines, and the medical professionals will be able to tell the person how and how often this should happen. Also, immune globulin, if that is potentially available. Once symptoms appeared, so once the virus reached the brain, there's nothing you can do, and then it's invariably fatal.
So how long is the incubation then?
The virus needs to travel to the brain. If you're bitten on the ankle, for example, there's a long way that the virus needs to travel all the way to the brain. If you're bitten in the neck, the travel time will be shorter. So then the incubation time will be shorter. So typically between 1 and 8 weeks for humans, but it can be shorter and it can be longer.
Talk to us about the incidence of rabies in developing countries, especially in Africa.
Good rabies control would rely on good public health measures and good public health infrastructure, and sometimes this is lacking. In many African countries, the way to prevent rabies in humans would be to eliminate it in dogs. Dogs need to be vaccinated, and we need to achieve herd immunity in dogs.
How can someone tell if a dog has rabies, or any animal for that matter?
There are signs in animals. Usually when animals act very aggressively where they shouldn't. In a rabies endemic country, if you are bitten by a dog, you should assume that there's a risk and you should immediately seek care. And I think that would be the advice also to anybody traveling to an African city. If you are bitten by a dog or you're exposed in some way, you should assume that there's a rabies risk and you should seek the necessary medical care. The World Rabies Day initiative is one of the things to make people more aware of this disease and that it is still a serious problem in many parts of the world. And it's an unnecessary problem. And the disease, in fact, had been eliminated in many countries of the world. And we need to create tools that would make it easier for them to do that. So advocacy, educational tools, and then tools like surveillance. Everybody now knows from the COVID pandemic how important surveillance is.
Professor Louis Nel, thank you so much. We appreciate your time.
Thank you, Linord.